Please consider becoming a patron of Myth Vision Podcast. You'll get early access to every video, including this amazing one. And you can ask me personal questions, private message me, anything you'd like.
The teachings that they call Gnostic really do come from Paul, many of them, and they come from the New Testament.
And Paul's...
I mean, people who don't like them will say, well, these are all foreign ideas. These are, you know, a bunch of Greek ideas, a bunch of pagan things all mixed in.
Say thanks to Paul then, you know, if that's what you want to say. But either way, Paul's doing that, and I think it's because of his audience. And it's a Hellenistic time. I think Paul's Hellenized, for sure. I mean, he obviously is.
Well, yeah, and he's teaching and writing in Greek.
Yeah.
I mean, but, and so are the Gospels. So they're translating whatever Jesus said in Aramaic into a language that would speak to a much wider audience than Jews.
This is the fifth video, I think.
Yep. Hey, we're really cooking here.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, I've got almost 50 questions.
Oh, okay.
3, 2, 1. Professor Elin Pagels, our fifth question will be, how did we get the Nag Hammadi Library, and are they authentic?
What we call the Nag Hammadi Library is a collection of about 50 ancient texts. They're about 2,000 years old. They were found in a cave, actually all in a very 6-foot jar. That's how you'd preserve a manuscript if you wanted to save it, so that it wouldn't just rot. And that's how the Dead Sea Scrolls were found. They were put in caves with sealed tops, put in jars with sealed tops, hidden in caves to protect them from the weather. And these texts were found hidden. They were taken out of a monastery in 4th century Egypt. These were texts that Christian monks loved and used in their devotions. But the bishop said, get rid of all those secret books. Those are the bad ones. I only want you to read the ones that are on my list. And his list happens to be the list that we now call the New Testament canon, which means standard collection. This is the basic standard collection. Get rid of the other ones. They'll just confuse you. He said, they're not all wrong, but I want you to think the way I think, and don't ask those questions. So these texts, when we found them, can include the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Peter, the Gospel of Mary Magdalene, the Gospel of Philip, the Gospel of Truth, a whole range of other perspectives on the early Christian movement that we just didn't have before. We were told there was a lot of heretical, terrible things people said, but we didn't know what these terrible heretics thought. Actually, the word heresy means choice, and that was something some bishops thought wasn't good for Christians. So they wanted all of these other texts buried because they raised too many questions. They opened up too many other ideas. So when we found them, are they authentic? Well, they are early Christian texts. We know that followers of Jesus were reading them about the time they were reading, say, the Gospel of John, maybe 50 or 60 years after the death of Jesus. So they're very early. Authentic is a judgment. I think that it's very likely some of the teachings that we find, say, in the Gospel of Thomas particularly, go back to Jesus. The reason for that is that the Gospel of Thomas doesn't have any stories in it. It's just 14 sayings. These are the secret sayings that the living Jesus spoke and the twin Judas Thomas wrote down. Now, half the Gospel of Thomas, it's only about 14 pages, half of it's identical with Matthew, identical with Luke. Love your brother, parable of the mustard seed, parable of the sower, it's just the same thing. Then there's another set of teachings which aren't in the New Testament. And those take you into a more thoughtful, deeper, mystical direction. So it seems that followers of Jesus collected his sayings. And this collection includes many of the private sayings that aren't in Matthew and Luke. So very likely, these come from Jesus. They sound very similar to his other teachings.
Has anyone tried to say they're forgeries, though, the ones that we got? Because in your book, you do discuss that there was black market situation happening. And, we're obviously trying to crack down on that kind of stuff with the recent forgeries that were discovered about the Dead Sea Scrolls. The owner of, one of the Christian owners of a store, famous, well-known store, found out the whole thing he had was all forgeries. Has anyone tried to make the accusation that these are forgeries?
Yes, certainly. There are people and there are Christian leaders who want to say, this is all garbage, just don't read that. I mean, my own professor told us initially when we started to read them, we just thought these were weird. just weird. And then he was very surprised to find out that they were very powerful and impressive. These texts discovered in Upper Egypt, however, have been tested to check that they are actually very ancient manuscripts. You can test by carbon dating to see what the material of the papyrus is, what kind of script was written in the second and third century, what kind of language is used. You can't really forge 52 ancient texts crumbling with the papyrus falling apart when you touch it. So these are ancient documents. Can we say that Jesus said everything in them? No. We can't say that about the Gospel of John either. So it's a fascinating detective story to try to figure that out.
I love it. And
I do too. It's fascinating.
Yeah, and when you said authentic, that's kind of a judgment statement. And I guess what I was getting at wasn't really that what you were poking at. It was simply, are they forgeries? Are they real? But I'm glad you brought that up.
They're
this
ancient.
Just goes into the same thing. Were these accepted? And the question, you answered that in our earlier video by saying, well, many Christians read these. At some point, I loved your book, The Gnostic Gospel, Gnostic Gospels, that they're trying to politically grab a hold of this thing. I mean, it took them quite a while to start wrapping their head around, how do we make this one faith, one church, one bishop, one God?
Yes, yes. How do we turn this into dogma? What do you believe? I believe in one God. I believe in Jesus, the Son of God. I believe, how do you turn the New Testament into that? It took 400 years. But we should also talk about the view of the resurrection in these texts, for example, or the view of the virgin birth.
Yeah.
I mean, shall we start over or shall we?
If you'd like to, go ahead and go for the resurrection.
Well, for example, the New Testament text suggests that after Jesus died, Matthew, Mark, and Luke say that his body was gone from the grave. And they suggest that perhaps he physically rose from the dead. And the early Christians just said, we believe that he was raised from the dead. They don't say that we believe his body physically got out of the grave. But raised from the dead means he died, but he's alive. We actually saw him. Does that mean we saw a body that we could touch? Some of the stories say yes, and some of the stories say no. As soon as we recognized him, he vanished. So the New Testament accounts aren't clear, because I think the people who wrote the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of John put different stories together. One of them will say, we actually touched him. We felt his flesh. The other one says, no. As soon as he spoke to us, he was gone, like a vision. So these followers were more concerned to say, we think he's alive, because a lot of people saw him in different ways. They don't care if it was this way or that way. They just say, we're going to accumulate all the stories we can of people who say that they actually saw him when alive again after he died, however it was that it happened. 200 years later, Christians are saying, well, no, either you've got to believe he got out of the grave and it was his body was raised up into heaven and you watched him go into the clouds the way Acts says in the first chapter of the book of Acts, or you say it was just, it was a vision. We could see a vision, the way Paul says, I saw him. And Paul never says he saw a person. He says, flashing light, a bright light that blinded him. He heard a voice. That was what he, all he saw was the light. All he heard was a voice. He didn't talk to a person. He said, there was a presence, a divine presence that spoke to me. So in the secret gospels, usually the resurrection is understood as an experience, as a spiritual experience, as a visionary experience, not as a physical proving that Jesus was back with the full body and the DNA present. Yeah. And that was taken by some followers of Jesus to be heresy. You had, in the second century, that some said, no, you have to believe that he was physically back, not just that he was somehow raised. That's not enough anymore. So Christian doctrine became kind of fossilized into certain specific ideas. Jesus is raised bodily from the dead. You've got to believe that that way now. And there were others who didn't. But that was useful for the Orthodox Church to say, we have the only doctrine that's right. You have to believe it the way our creed says it. And if you don't believe it the way our creed says it and believe it literally, you're out. Because one thing institutions like is to have the answers and to be, as you said, authorities. Mm-hmm. If we can have different points of view and recognize each other as coming up with different spiritual understandings, that doesn't work for an authoritarian church.
There's so much more about this that I'd like to probe, and it's amazing. Thank you so much.